Welcome to the Friends with Money podcast, brought to you by Money Magazine, creating financial freedom for Australians since 1999.
Hello, and welcome to another episode of the Friends with Money podcast. My name is Michelle Baltazar. I'm the editor-in-chief here at Money Magazine. Thank you for joining us. Today, I'm joined by Stephen Timm, who is the managing director of Home In, a digital home buying concierge, who had me at the word concierge in the name of the company. And we want to discuss, and hopefully Stephen can explain, what are all these stamp duty reforms that we're kind of hearing on the radio or watching on TV. Stephen, welcome to Friends with Money.
Thanks, Michelle. Good morning. Great to talk to you.
No dramas. So I wanted to ask, first of all, for those who haven't come across Home In before, what is it actually that, what service do you provide?
Yeah, for sure. As you said, so Home In is a digital home buying concierge. Our objective really is to help home buyers going through that home buying process, showing them step by step what it is that they need to do and giving them access to all of the services they need, including conveyancing.
Yes, and I think the key word there is first-time home buyers. It's really kind of overwhelming thinking about all the things that you have to organize before you go out and take out a big loan from the bank.
Yeah, that's right, absolutely. And just on that, if you don't mind, as many as 60% of our customers in Home In are first home buyers. And first home buyers tell us they really appreciate the guidance and the step-by-step nature of the application that really walks them through the process all the way from, I'm interested in this property to settlement and getting the keys. We also support subsequent home buyers though. Their benefit from the system is a little bit different in the sense of, for them, it's really about the convenience. So able to do it at night through the app. Once the kids are in bed, it's really, supports them in particular those people who are a bit more time poor.
Yes. Now, one of the big things about purchasing your first home is thinking about the stamp duty costs. Now, according to your research, you've found that on average, a home buyer in Queensland would pay $13,500 in stamp duty costs, New South Wales, $29,000, and in Victoria, $38,000. But even if you look at, say, an average house in Victoria that's valued at $824,000, they're paying $44,500 in stamp duty tax. So no wonder there's all this talk about reforms. So can you walk us through what are the changes and why are they beneficial for first-time home buyers?
Sure, absolutely. So the key change that's happened recently is in New South Wales. They've introduced something called the First Home Buyer's Choice. And the idea here is that first home buyers would be able to choose between paying a land tax, an annual recurring land tax, or the upfront stamp duty. There's a range of details on each of them and what they look like, but I think the real benefit here for first home buyers is the option to reduce the amount of upfront cost in buying the property. So the essence of stamp duty is it's based on the purchase price of the property. There's a few details in the calculation itself, but essentially based on the purchase price of the property, there's an upfront lump sum that buyers have to pay. Land tax, on the other hand, is paid in a small annual amount over the lifetime of owning that property. And typically, while each situation can be different, typically the upfront cost for someone choosing land tax would be significantly smaller. And even the lifetime cost, unless they end up owning the property for, in excess of anywhere from 20 to 40 years, the land tax option should give them a lower total cost.
All right. So that's in New South Wales. What about in other states?
So this is New South Wales has sort of led the movement here towards land tax. I think there has been a lot of discussion, particularly in Victoria recently, leading up to their elections around land tax and the potential to move away from stamp duty. As you mentioned earlier, it does seem like land tax in Victoria is considered a bit higher than in some of the other states. And it's certainly something of interest there. It's unclear as to how this will move across the country. I think the, home in being a national service, we're hearing from customers all over the country around it would be great to have a more consistent view on what's happening with land tax and how this might work nationally. And I think certainly it is a worthwhile debate for us as a nation to consider. How do we potentially move away from stamp duty, to something more productive like a land tax?
Yes, I know. But even as you talk about how can we move away from stamp duty, and I can almost see my local council going, but Michelle, it's regular income for us. Don't take that away from us. But why do you think an annual property tax makes more sense for today's kind of, typical Aussie family? I mean, in the past, you buy a house, you're there for like 60 years. But tell us why an annual property tax makes more sense.
Yeah, it's a great question. The obviously, particularly for first home buyers, as I mentioned earlier, the land tax reduces the amount of upfront cost for those buyers. So that means buyers have a bit more choice of what property they can afford up front and are helping them get into the market, particularly with housing affordability, as we know, across the nation, quite challenging. And particularly in the current environment where cost of living is quite high. So I think the first point is really clear one. It helps with reduce the upfront costs. The idea of taking a land tax and having that available more broadly, I think, also supports the idea of people being more mobile, more likely to move houses through their lifetime. You mentioned previously, it wasn't uncommon for someone to live in the same house for 60 years or so, whereas these days people are really far more mobile. Family structures are changing. They're moving for jobs, they are moving to different states and so on. So the ability of a land tax to support someone to move to a different property depending on where they want to live or for work, I think provides a lot more flexibility. It's good from an economic perspective to be able to have people more mobile and be able to move for work. I think it's good from people's well-being perspective. We know one of the biggest drivers of well-being relates to commute times to work. And so as people move jobs through their career, being able to also move houses easily and be closer to work, we believe is valuable.
Let's say this happens, right? So miraculously, we have now moved away from stamp duties and we're on to a trial of land taxes, for example. How would that impact housing prices?
It's a great question. I think there's a number of implications for property prices. I think importantly, though, the consideration is the transition from the current stamp duty regime to land tax. As you mentioned earlier, there are a number of local government and state governments who do receive significant tax revenue from stamp duty, and it's important to consider the implications of that. The implications are for existing homeowners who may have paid stamp duty and so on in any transition. So I think the most sensible way forward would be a gradual transition. There's a number of options around how that transition would happen. And as a result, I think through a sensible gradual transition, I believe like any impact on property prices would be fairly minimal.
I think that's a good thing because you don't want to drive prices even further than where they are now. And finally, what are other ways that first-time home buyers can save money other than, paying stamp duty and other relevant property taxes?
Well, I mean, the choice of land tax versus stamp duty is a really important one for first-time buyers to consider. And it's worthwhile adding to that, there remain a number of other stamp duty concessions for first-time buyers. So, for example, in New South Wales, the First Home Buyers Assistance Scheme is not changing. That scheme involves a reduction or concessions on stamp duty. So, for example, for a purchase less than $650,000 for eligible purchases, their stamp duty is effectively reduced to zero. So those existing first home buyer schemes in New South Wales will remain. And it's very valuable for first home buyers to look at those, as well as this new option of choice for purchases up to 1.5 million. There's a range of these sorts of schemes and considerations across the country. Different states and territories have different versions of these. It's certainly something that all first home buyers should explore. We do see a number of customers or buyers who will purchase and only after purchasing realize that, hey, as a first home buyer, I may have been eligible for these. So it's certainly something for HomeIn and for our customers. We make sure to bring that to the forefront for them early in the discussion. But I'd encourage anyone going through the process of buying a home to look at where you are purchasing. Are you eligible for any of these sorts of benefits? Because there are a number of them, and they're not always straightforward to understand, both in terms of eligibility, but also what's available. So it's definitely worth doing the research, given that buying a property is one of the biggest financial transactions many people make in their lives.
I think we do that, right? We make a big purchase, and it's only after we've made the purchase that someone says to us, oh, did you know that you would have been eligible for like a 10% discount or a 5% discount? And you're like, why are you telling me this now? Like, you could have told me that half an hour ago before I did this purchase. But that is one of the things. I think that's a very useful money tip, whether it's buying a house or a car or whatever big decision. Just ask that question. Are there any discounts? Are there any special offers? Or in this case, are there any concessions or government programs? Because they are trying to help people afford buying a home. I mean, housing affordability has been a big issue that now the government's kind of ramping up all these different schemes.
No, absolutely. And I would definitely support your point there. I think if we think about home buying, the idea that people buy homes fairly rarely, you know, typically people might buy 3 to 4 homes over their lifetime. So they're not necessarily experts in it. And even if they have done it before, the chances are some of the processes might have changed, some of the concessions and other opportunities might have changed. So it's definitely important for buyers to do their research up front or engage someone like HomeIn who is doing it very regularly, is across what they might be able to have access to and may be eligible for, and can help them through that process.
Yes, we're talking about savings of thousands of dollars there if you just kind of add that extra step when you purchase a home. So once again, thank you for joining us, Stephen. Those were really useful tips.
It's a pleasure, Michelle. Really great to talk to you.
Now, before we go, don't forget that if you enjoy listening to the Friends with Money podcast, we'd love for you to recommend it to your own friends and family, or you can help us out by leaving a review on iTunes or the Apple Podcast app. You can also send in any questions, comments, or even topics you'd love for us to cover, including any questions you have on purchasing your first property, through our dedicated email, which is podcast@moneymag.com.au. And finally, make sure you head over to moneymag.com.au for all the latest financial news and stories. That's it for this episode. I'm Michelle Baltazar. Bye for now.
Thanks for listening to the Friends with Money podcast. For credible, independent, and easy to understand financial commentary, visit moneymag.com.au. Please remember that the views and opinions expressed in this podcast are general in nature, and further independent advice and research based on your personal circumstances should be sought before making an investment decision.